time. Bring your friends.
And now Child Roland to the Dark Tower came. My first thought was he lied in every word, that hoary cripple, with malicious eye askance to watch the working of his lie on mine, and mouth scarce able to afford suppression of the glee that pursed and scored its edge at one more victim gained thereby. What else should he be set for with his staff? What, save to waylay with his lies, ensnare all travelers who might find him posted there, and ask the road? I guess what skull-like laugh would break, what crutch didn't write my epitaph for pastime in the dusty thoroughfare. If at his counsel I should turn aside into that ominous tract which, I'll agree, hides the dark tower, yet acquiescently I did turn as he pointed, neither pride nor hope rekindling at the end of this cried, so much as gladness at some end might be. For what, with my whole wide world wandering, what with my search drawn out through years, my hope, dwindled into a ghost not fit to cope, with that joy success would bring, I hardly tried now to rebuke the spring my heart made, finding failure in its scope. As when a sick man, very near to death, seems dead indeed, and feels begin and end the tears, and takes a farewell of each friend, and hears one bid the other go, draw breath, freer outside, and the blow fallen no grieving can amend. While some discuss if near the other graves be room enough for this, and when a day suits best for carrying the corpse away, with care about the banners, scarves, and staves, and still the man hears all, and only craves he may not shame such tender love and stay. Thus I had so long suffered in this quest, heard failure prophesied so oft, been read so many times among the band, to wit, the knights who to the dark tower search addressed their steps, that just to fail as they seem best, and all the doubt was now, should I be fit? So quiet as despair I turned from him, that hateful cripple, out of his highway into the path he pointed. All the day had been a dreary one at best, and dim, was setting to its close, yet shot one grim red leer to see the plain crutch in its astray. For mark, no sooner was I fairly found pledged to the plain, after a pace or two, than, pausing to throw backward a last view o'er the safe road, 'twas gone, gray plain all around, nothing but plain to the horizon's bound. I might go on. Naught else remained to do. So on I went. I think I never saw such starved, ignoble nature. Nothing throve. For flowers, as well expect a cedar grove. But cockle spurge, according to their law, might propagate their kind with none to awe. You'd think our burr had been a treasure's trove. Not perjury, inertness, and grimace, in some strange sort, were the land's portion. Or shut your eyes, said nature peevishly. If nothing skills, I cannot help my case. 'Tis the last judgment's fire must cure this place, calcine its claws, and set my prisoners free. If there pushed any ragged thistle stalk above its mates, the head was chopped. The bent were jealous else. What made those holes and rents in the dock's harsh, swarth leaves, bruised as to balk, all hope of greenness? 'Tis a brute must walk, put passing their life out with a brute's intent. As for the grass, it grew scant as hair in leprosy. Thin dry blades pricked the mud, which underneath looked kneaded up with blood. One stiff blind horse, as every bone a stare, stood stupefied, however he came there, thrust out past service from the devil's stud. Alive? He might be dead for aught I know, with that red gaunt and collapsed neck a-strain, and shut eyes underneath the rusty mane, seldom went such grotesqueness, with such woe, I never saw a brute I hated so. He must be wicked to deserve such pain. I shut my eyes and turned them on my heart, as a man calls for wine.
house will rock. Blind boys don't lie. So clear through broken walls, that scream I hear. Cry, little sister. Temptation heat beats like a drum.